Yeah, I'm starting, and here is your timer and your question. Right, so if you have read and understood, considering the clinical examination station, kindly begin.
Yes, I will start by wash my hands. And I will ask the patient, good morning, I'm Mr. Muhammad, one of surgical doctors here. Can I confirm your name and age, please, ma'am?
I'm Elizabeth, 62 years old.
Yes, nice to meet you. Today I'm going to examine glands in your neck. It will include general look and close look to your neck, beside examining your head, your eyes, and hands and legs. Do you agree with this, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Do you have any pain at the moment before we start?
No, go ahead.
So, if you don't mind, can you take a seat in this chair, please? And can you unbuttoning the first two buttons of your shirt?
Yes.
And little bit straighten your neck to face a little bit the ceiling.
Yes.
So now in front of the patient, I will sit and take a close look to the neck to assess any swelling of the neck in form of both sides, either
yes.
right or left side, in form of any swelling site, size, shape, surface, scan over it, any signs of inflammation or any scar or any tethering or attachment. Either to the right side or the left side. And then I will ask the patient, please, ma'am, can you open your mouth and stick your tongue out, please? And we'll assess any movement of this swelling. Can you take a sip of water, hold it in your mouth, and you can swallow now? Now I will ask the patient that now I am going to examine you from behind. Do you have any pain at the moment? And before that, I will ask her to just tense her chin against my hand to detect the swelling overlapped by overlying muscle or not. Then I will come from the back of the patient and just straighten a little bit the neck. Then I will go below the lower edge of the swelling. And firstly, an assess. By the back of my hand, any hotness and the temperature, and will feel the swelling one by one. By bending, asking the patient, the man, please, can you bend your head to the right shoulder, please, to feel the right swelling by my right hand. I will assess also a size, shape, a surface, any tenderness by looking for the eyes. And any palpable pulsation. Also, assess the other swelling in, for the same with any the edge, consistency, and surface, any attachment of the skin by benching the skin. And we'll ask the patient to assess press against my hand by chin and assess the movement. Also, now I am going to feel the gland in your neck. I will start by circular group, submental, submandibular, and periauricular, posterior, occipital, and longitudinal group along the anterior border of sternomastoid muscle. So now I will feel also the peritrachea, perilaryngeal group. And now I will tell the patient, I will feel pulse in your neck, carotid pulse, assess for any vein visible. Now I will feel that your wind bulb may be a little bit uncomfortable. In both sides, Okay, this now I will ask the patient that I will take a close look for your additionally, I will ask the patient to take a sip of water and feel the swelling. Stick your tongue out and feel the swelling also. Now I will take a close look for your eyes from the side, from the other side, from the front and from the back, to assess any presence of any exophthalmos. Now I will take a seat in front of the patient, ask him to see a fixed point at the wall, keep your head still, and follow my finger in H-shaped pattern, and ask yes. the patient if you feel pain or double vision, let me know. Also the same position, ask the patient to follow my object from up downward to detect any lead lag. Then ask the patient that I will keep your head still and push my finger in front of him about 15 centimeters for conversion. Also, I will ask the patient, can you put your hands in front of you, spill your finger? I will put a paper on top of it to detect any tremors. I will feel pulse in your hands, any sweating on both sides in the palm of the hand. And ask the patient, Beth, do you have any shoulder pain? I will raise your hands as much as you can to detect a water homal pulse. And now I will detect the temperature in your field temperature of your hands. Then I will tap in your elbow on my finger to detect the biceps reflex, exposing biceps muscle. Now, if you don't mind, can you roll out your trousers upward to detect the pre-tibial edema? And with your hands crossed to each other, can you stand up for me to detect proximal myopsy? As additionally, I can put, can you put your leg one on the other, cross the other one to detect the ankle reflex, exposing quadriceps muscle tapping on the patellar tendon?
And can you please present your case now?
Yes, thanks. You can rest now. I pass my notes to my consultant to figure out your issue. Thank you for your time. Today, I examined a man 62 years old who presented with non-painful swelling in 8 months ago. On examination, the patient has swelling in the right side of the neck, about 5 to 4 centimeters. I can get the lower edge of the swelling with nodular surface, no scar over it, no signs of tenderness or hotness with the firm consistency, bulbable carotid bulge, no bulbable gland. The other side is free with tapping through the chest, no retrosternal extension, and bulbable carotid bulge, and the centralized trachea. Otherwise, the thyroid status, just fine tremors on the hand. Otherwise, no exophthalmos, no normal eye movements, and no lead lag, no pre-tibial edema, or with normal reflexes, not okay. exaggerated.
What are your provisional diagnosis?
Yes, as regard my provisional diagnosis is simple multinodular goiter, but also according to the age and the complaint of the patient, I consider thyroid to blast. So to complete my examination, I must to do after history taking and the clinical examination to ultrasound with the fine needle aspiration cytology or core biopsy besides thyroid profile. Then the patient after that will be discussed in MDT team, including endocrinologist, anesthetist, and surgeon for possibility of the surgery or medical treatment. But the patient with compressive symptoms will need surgery because he developed a discomfort with the swallowing. So the patient will need thyroidectomy. Yes.
Good. Exactly on time. Excellent. And you have also mentioned every step. I don't see anything that you have missed. Good. Very good.
Thank improvement. You.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Started the timer, and here is your question. Since we have recently done crush and bridge, so it's RT and ETLS. Almost the same or close to what you have prepared, so shouldn't be a problem.
I will able to do that, ma'am. No issue.
Yes, I realize. Right, so if you have read and understood concerning the medical care scenario, kindly please tell me what would you do next?
Ma'am, as the patient brought in the emergency in an unconscious patient, I will follow a ATLS protocol. I will secure the airway, stabilize the cervical spine. I will check the breathing. I will see any extra. There is no external compression. I will check for the peripheral pulses. I will expose and look for any occult injuries, and I will take a sample for blood cross matching also, sir, ma'am.
How would
and,
you be for the airway?
Ma'am, I will clear the airway. I will do the suctioning. I will clear the airway, and if required, I can put a artificial airway, for example, Goodall's airway, ma'am.
All right. Okay. All right. What would you do to ensure breathing is taking place?
Ma'am, I will check there is no external compression over the chest, ma'am. And I will try to, if there is any tachycardia, I will try to give him a...
Patient is having difficulty in breathing and there are abrasions.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, yes, ma'am.
That's why I want you to tell me, how would you reassure?
Ma'am, I will give the patient oxygen, ma'am. Yes. High flow oxygen, ma'am. I will try to prop up the bed, ma'am. And yes. I will try to stabilize the pelvic injury with a pelvic binder, ma'am.
Okay. Considering the injuries that patient has acquired, how would you evaluate what level of shock patient has?
Ma'am, as the patient is having a unconscious and having a pelvic injury with the open tibiofibular fracture, ma'am, it is a hemorrhagic shock, hypovolemic shock, ma'am.
Grade four. Yes. All right. So, what made you think that it is grade four?
Ma'am, as a patient is unconscious and there is unstable vitals, ma'am.
All right. Very good. So, how this grade four of hemorrhagic shock should be managed?
Ma'am, I will follow ATLS protocol, ma'am. I will check for the pulse rate. I will catheterize the patient. I will look for the vitals, ma'am. I will check for the blood pressure. I will check for capillary refill time. I will monitor the ECG. I will get a IV access. I will start the fluid resuscitation with the crystalloid. And I will check for, get the sample for labs investigation. I will start with the warm crystalloid solution.
Very good.
If patient is not responding, I will switch to colloid, ma'am.
Very good. Okay. Can you please tell me what are the parameters that you'll be monitoring and how frequently?
Ma'am, every hourly, ma'am, I will check for every 30 minutes, I will check for
every
pulse 30 rate.
Minutes. Good.
And every pulse rate, ma'am, blood pressure, capillary refill time, urinary output, ma'am. These are the parameters I will monitor.
Mental status as well.
And okay. Mental status.
How would you decide which injury to manage first? Pelvic fracture or the open tibiofibular fracture. Or
ma'am, I will manage the. Ma'am, I will try to stabilize the pelvic injury because it can bleed a lot and it can lead to loss of blood in the dead space, ma'am, retroperitoneal space, ma'am. So okay. I will stabilize the pelvis by applying a pelvic binder in the emergency itself.
Considering it's a pelvic fracture, what are the risks or the complications that you should be aware of or look out for?
Ma'am, because pelvic injury can be a open, it can be a anterior posterior type, it can be a lateral compression type, it can be vertical shear type, or it can be a mixed type. So there can be a rupture of urethra, there can be a rupture of bladder, there can be a renal injury, there can be a perineal injury, ma'am, or it can lead to vascular injury, ma'am.
Yes, but what are the risks that you should be extra conscious? Especially there is a tibiofibular fracture as well, pelvic fracture. So you should look out for the pulmonary embolism.
Yes, ma'am. I will look for the pulmonary embolism.
This is the kind of answer I was looking for. Oh. Okay. So how would you prevent that from happening? Why you suggested pelvic binder?
Ma'am, to stabilize, to
Yes.
immobilize and to stabilize the pelvic,
Yes.
ma'am, there will
Very
be
good.
no motion at the fracture site, ma'am.
Okay. Very good. Okay. This was the, all right. What else? Who would you involve in this? In the
Ma'am,
management of this patient?
I will involve an orthopedic
Yes.
surgeon. I will involve the intensive care specialist. I can involve the an anesthesiologist, ma'am.
Okay, good. Where would the management take place?
Ma'am, patient should be monitored in the intensive care unit, ma'am.
All right. Okay. If what fluids would you give and how would you calculate the dose of maintenance fluid for this
Ma'am,
patient?
ma'am, I will start with the crystalloid solution, ma'am.
Yes.
If the patient is not
How much
responding, then
would
I
you
will
give
switch.
initially and then what would be the
Ma'am, I
maintenance
will
dose?
start with the ma'am, I'm not sure. I will start with 1 liter, ma'am.
Yes,
I'm not sure.
then
I'm not sure,
according
ma'am.
to the
Sorry.
weight, how would you calculate or according to the condition RT? Okay, you'll read that.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, okay. So, right. I must have asked. Okay. To prevent the risk factors like DVT or pulmonary embolism, what measures would you take?
Ma'am, I will apply the compression stockings, ma'am, to the patient, and I will start the patient on the after checking for the coagulation profile, I will start the patient on low molecular weight heparin.
Okay. How much dose would you
ma'am,
suggest?
40. For enoxaparin 40 mm milligram subcutaneous dose, ma'am, daily.
Okay. And how would you follow that? Is
ma'am,
there any
I will
test that you? Yes.
Ma'am, I will go check for INR, ma'am, International Normalized Standard Score.
How
ma'am,
much
I will check
should
for
that
that.
Be?
Two to three, ma'am.
Okay, right. You still have time. Okay, what investigations, right? Is there any, no, there is nothing else. Okay. What type of management can you offer for open tibial fibular fracture?
Ma'am, for the open tibial fibular fracture, ma'am, I will look for the wound, ma'am. I will apply a fixator and
yes.
Do the debridement, ma'am, in the initial stage.
Yes.
After consulting with the orthopedic team, ma'am.
Orthopedic team or in your MDT team as well. All right. Would you or would you not consider giving blood to the patient?
Yes, ma'am. I will consider if the patient is the HB is dropping, ma'am. I will consider the patient for blood transfusion.
Okay. How would you decide? How much unit would you transfuse?
Ma'am, sorry, ma'am.
What
I have
is
to read
massive transfusion? Can you define?
If you will give more than 6 units in over 24 hours.
Okay. What else is possible that you are in? You are transfusing blood and you are giving fluid as well. So what
ma'am,
are the
can,
risk factors? But it
ma'am,
can
it
lead
can,
to.
Ma'am, it can lead to hyperkalemia, ma'am, and it can
or
lead to
fluid
acidosis.
Overloaders. Yes.
Fluid overload and acidosis, ma'am.
Yes. How would you reassure not to,
ma'am,
not this to happen? Yes.
Ma'am, I will look for the electrolytes as well as I will give a calcium to the patient, ma'am. IV calcium gluconate to prevent hypokalemia, ma'am. As well as I will monitor the urine output.
And you will follow the electrolyte.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Very good. Okay. Good. Thank you. Started the timer, and here is your question. Right. So if you have read and understood, considering its communication station, can you please begin?
Yes, okay. I'm ready. So, hello, I am Mr. Mohammed, surgical registrar in charge today, working for Mr. Mann in King's College Hospital. Just I want to speak to Mr. Patel and call consultant today. Can I ask, can I confirm that I am speaking to Mr. Patel or anyone else, please?
Yes, I am.
Yes. Hello, Mr. Patel. I just call you to update you about a female patient in our hospital, about 78 years old. She underwent a mastectomy with axillary clearance for breast cancer 2 days ago. Unfortunately, the patient today is unwell. We noted that she developed axillary swelling and a suction drain from the wound revealed about 90 ml of fresh blood. Additionally, she developed a shortness of breath. And also the patient had a background of COPD and the mild left ventricular fibrillation. So the issue today, I want to update you regarding this. The patient is unwell and her daughter wants to take her to her home. And the patient is not well. And unsuccessfully, I try to persuade the patient and the daughter that this discharge will be against medical advice and not in the patient's best interest. That what I want to update you regarding this.
So I just want to ask about the patient. Does he is competent and can make her decision alone, or she got any insisted from or pursued from her daughter?
Yeah. So as regard the patient and if you're from the patient notes, I noted that there is nothing. Evident that there is obstacle about taking informed decision, but I think that her daughter has convinced her that taking her to her home today will be best. But I think the patient needed to go home when she well enough to go home.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you think has happened at this patient?
Yes, as regard initially the axillary swelling and fresh blood coming from the vacuum drain, maybe due to reactionary hemorrhage, and there is a drop of hemoglobin. So as regard the shortness of breath, I must consider that due to old age and post-operative period, maybe due to DVT of axillary vein, developing into pulmonary embolism. Also, I consider the other pulmonary complication in form of atelectasis and pneumonia, as the patient has a background of COPD. This is as regard the patient and the developing of these issues.
Do you have any plan? What do you arrange for this case if she stay in the hospital? About this complication?
Yes, as regard the initially the axillary swelling and fresh blood from the vacuum drain, I will order a new hemoglobin set. If there is ongoing drop of hemoglobin and increase the swelling, it will need to be evacuated and to control the source of bleeding. This is firstly. Secondly, as regard the shortness of breath, assuming normal renal function, I consider request a CT pulmonary angiography to exclude pulmonary embolism and the doplex on the venous, in the deep veins of the upper limb due to the nature of the axillary clearance for the breast cancer and the hypercoagulability with malignancy, and chest X-ray, also ABG and the ECG to figure out or to exclude other pulmonary complication for this patient. So okay, do you have any added notes or to add for?
No, it's fine, plan? But if she insists to discharge, what will we do?
Yes, if she insisted, either the patient or her daughter, I will inform both the patient and her daughter that the patient must sign the local legal document that she had the full responsibility of ongoing any adverse complication or outcomes on any issues or danger to her life. Also, that the advice of continuous admission in the hospital was done, but she decided to discharge against the medical advice. This is as regards the legal document. But as regards the safety for the patient, I will told her and her daughter for symptoms and signs, which are alarming, for which she must attend to the nearby hospital or to attend here and to call me or SHO on a charge in form of being unwell, increase axillary swelling, increase fresh blood coming from the drain, or increase shortness of breath. And this is our plan and what I will tell the patient and her daughter.
I have a question. What do you do? What do you do for drain if she insists to discharge?
Yes, as regards to the drain in this procedure is critical. So I will advise the patient to follow with the nearby hospital GP to follow the drain follow up and discharge or wound care. Otherwise, it will be beneficial to avoid the collection of any hematoma or blood or seroma. So it will be followed by her GP.
I just clarify one. I need to check if I understand what you say. Yeah. You discharge her with the drain and her GP looking after the drain?
Yes.
Explain why. Okay. Tell why.
Okay.
Yes. So do you have any added notes to prescribe for the patient or either for the safety or post-operative management?
No, I don't have. But we couldn't discharge a patient with a drain because she's unsafe. She insists to discharge on her responsibility, so she'd remove the drain.
No, I will not remove that drain. I will ask the patient to seek the advice of her GP to follow the wound of the surgery and follow up also of the drain to avoid further complication of the wound.
Okay, thank you very much for you.
Thank you, Mr. Patel. Thank you. Okay.
Good, very good. You covered everything. And Dr. Mohammed, second time, it was very good. You explained and you conveyed your whole message across. Anyone else want to give feedback? Dr. Zafar, do you want to give feedback?
I said it is done very well.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, and all points were covered this time.
Yeah. Covered all points.
And
yeah.
It sounded like a communication going on between you as a consultant and him as a candidate. So that was good. That's the only purpose, you know, that once the communication should go on as per schedule or as per demand. Very good.
Inshallah.
Okay. Started the timer and here is your question. Right. So if you have read and understood, considering yes. the history taking station, kindly begin.
Yes, I am ready. Good morning, I'm Mr. Ghaziran of Surgical Dr. Ray. Can I confirm your name and age, please, ma'am?
Dr. Dafa?
Yes, sir. I'm Dafa. My date of birth, 9 of September, 1976.
Yes, nice to meet you. How can I help you today, please?
I just suffering from severe pain in my head.
Yes, I'm really sorry for that. But if you don't mind, can I ask you some question regarding your issue? Are you okay with this?
Yes, I'm yes. okay with this. But I need to tell you, I have appointment after 10 minutes. If you can finish this in 10 minutes.
You have what?
Appointment. You can reassure, yes, you will do it.
Yes. I'm really sorry for that. I do apologize for any delay. But I noticed that you are sensitive to the light. Can I turn off the light for you?
Yes, please.
Yes, can you lay down on the couch, please? So yes. You say that you have a headache. I'm really sorry for that. Are you in need in painkiller or analgesia now?
No, it's fine.
Okay, can you point at the site of the pain, please, or this headache?
Yes, it is in my back of head, yeah.
Yes, when did it start, firstly, please?
It started before 2 years.
2 years, for yeah. the first time? Yeah,
and no, the last one? This is the second time. For the yes, this... first time, yeah, it is 1 year. It is three days, yeah.
Yes, the last time that for which you attended today, from how much hours?
So for about 3 days.
3 days. So yeah. Can you describe this pain, please? The nature of this
pain? Yeah, it look like dull pain in the back. Yes, it's mostly come in the early morning.
Yeah. So did it move anywhere else?
No.
No. Okay, so it is specific for certain time at the early morning only?
Yes, I said early morning, yeah.
Yes, so can you rate out this pain out of 10, please?
No, it's about 4.
4. So did it affect your daily life?
Yes, when we suffer from the pain, so... Yes, it affects my life. So, but what do you mean by affect my life?
Yes, so affecting your occupation and your daily activity, baseline of daily activity, any ascending stairs and so on.
Yeah. Sometimes I feeling blockout. So when you take up the stair, yeah.
Yeah, I'm really sorry for that. Are you in need for painkiller now to prescribe?
No. I said that I'm fine.
So, have you noted that it is started gradually or suddenly?
Yes, it is started gradually. It is for gradually. A long time, yeah.
Yeah, progressive in course or stationary or decrease?
I looking it start to be increase.
Increase. So, so now, are you feeling any neck stiffness, please?
No.
No neck stiffness. So do you have any skin rash or change in the color of your skin?
No.
So any fever?
I have sometime fever, but it's not related to my headache, so I think.
Okay, so before occurrence of this headache twice, have you noted that you are fearful or there are warning signs you feel that it will come before occurrence of the headache?
I feel sick. I feel sick. Yeah.
Yeah. Feel sick. Did you have any blackouts?
I have one. Yeah.
One. So I'm really sorry for that. So any vomiting?
No, I just feel sick.
Feel sick. So any blurring of vision?
Sometime, yeah.
So any discharge from ear or your nose?
No.
No. So I will ask you some question, socially. Don't worry. So what do you do for life, please?
Worry about what?
It's your person. What do you do for life, please? Okay. Your occupation.
Okay.
So, what's your occupation, please?
I'm working in the shop, Aldi shop.
Yeah. Okay. With the home you are living?
I live with my wife.
So, do you have any medical condition? Do you have treated for it?
Just hypertensive. I take medication called nifedipine one time per day. Yeah.
Any renal issue? The kidney issue?
No.
Okay. So, any family member had like sinister in your brain?
And my father, he's died from the CA brain.
I'm really sorry for that.
So, can you present your history now?
Yes, thank you for your time. I'll pass my notes to my consultant to figure out your issue. Today, I took a history from 53-year-old lady who presented of a headache at the back of her head twice. The first one is about 1 year ago. The last one is 3 days ago. It's about dull aching, increase in the early morning, dull pain, rating about 4, really to respond to painkiller. She is sensitive to the light. The pain is not radiating to anywhere. There are morning neck stiffness with no rash, mild fever, but not related to the headache. The pain occurred, the gradual onset with progressive course. Yes. Otherwise,
so what are your differential diagnosis?
Yes, my top differential diagnosis was positive family history is subarachnoid hemorrhage causing headache, but I will consider other causes in form of migraine, meningitis, encephalitis, also brain, specifically by lesion, increased intraocular pressure. Yes.
How do you suggest to manage this patient?
This patient, I will manage the patient according to patient of hemorrhage. So ABCD approach.
Very good, yes.
Yes, but considering avoid any straining in form of keep the patient stable and calm, considering normal IV fluid taken at least 3 liters and avoid straining in form of giving the patient laxative, nomodobin, vasodilator in form of 60 milligram every 4 hours, give the patient painkiller in form of Pisidin, avoid morphia, and asking some investigation form of hemoglobin level, also CT brain or MRI to detect the source of the bleeding. And also discuss the patient in neurovascular MDT for availability of coiling of the aneurysm or treatment in form of surgery, in form of Barhor or craniectomy.
All right, good. Okay, yeah. Right. If time would have allowed you, what else would you have asked?
I must to ask the patient about the eyes, any concern?
Yes. Anything else?
Yes. Yes. Social history about smoking, alcohol drinking. Medical conditions. I'll ask it. Surgical history, drug history, and any allergy.
Yes.
And also, I must check about anything about systematic review in form of chest pain, any palpitation, any joint pain, any backache, any problem with change of bowel habits or waterworks. Any
history of trauma.
History of trauma. Yes. Did you bang?
Because this is second episode. The first episode, if you should ask patient remembers head being hit on the floor, so maybe there was a trauma then, but then he said 1 year ago first attack was occurred, so maybe it's not that old.
Yes.
1 year ago. It was in exam, it will be a more recent. Yes, good. So saying it is as good as doing it. So as soon as the bell goes and you're presenting your case, try the opportunity to tell the examiner that you will complete, if time would have allowed you, would have asked the eyes and all these things that you're asking, that you're telling me.
Yes.
Good. Because then it is as good as being asked or being done. One question. Once you were taking history, in history taking, you will not ask the patient to lie down on the couch, no matter what that is. But you can ask them to sit down if they want. Like you asked, if light is giving you trouble, I can turn it off, I can sit it down. If you are in too much pain, I can give you painkiller or analgesia. So that was good. You can even ask if they want a glass of water to calm them down. Because, yeah. But here, question is, patient has a headache. Would you ask the patient for a glass of water or not?
Yes. Wait, for what?
A glass of water to drink. Patient is already nauseating. Should you or should you not?
The patient has a history of any blackouts or loss of consciousness. So, and he is drowsy.
Yes.
So it's not eligible to ask the patient
you will not. Good. But you will not even ask the patient to lie down. You can ask the patient to sit if the patient is standing or not willing to cooperate. But in history taking, you will not have something.
I asked the patient to lay down to make him relaxed or
relax,
avoid
yes.
straining.
Yes.
As straining is the one of the management to avoid, to avoid increase in the intracranial pressure or to increase the hemorrhage, to avoid increase the hemorrhage. So I asked the patient to turn off the light as he is usually sensitive for
photophobia.
Yes, and the second one, make the patient is relaxed and you can consider asking the patient to lay down on the couch to make him relaxed.
Yes, I understand, but I don't think you should in exam because there you won't be able to. They won't relax like this and they won't lie down like that.
Yeah.
So okay. So it's good. Right, let me...